All right, I want to start this off by saying this is a game I didn't really know what to expect from. I'll come back to this, but this game is actually a sequel to a game I never played, but I knew of for many, many years. So keep that in mind. But that said, after spending a lot of time with this and going through it, I actually do like it a lot, and it's a lot better than I expected to be. I guess in my head, because it's Alice in Wonderland, I was thinking, you know, the Disney movie type of Alice, but no, this is a much more twisted, messed up, darker version of Alice in Wonderland, and I guess maybe that's kind of one of the reasons I like it, because the whole game does have a very kind of Tim Burton-esque feel to it, which is pretty cool, and has a whole gothic feel to it. It's very different than the Alice in Wonderland probably many of us are familiar with, and as the game kind of promotes itself, it's not exactly as you remember, and we're all mad here, so it does fit that quite well. Let's put it that way. It's an action platformer, and Alice Madness Returns was developed by Spicy Horse and published by EA in 2011. I have the computer version here, but it's also for the PlayStation 3 and the Xbox 360. And I remember seeing this quite a few years ago when it first came out, but I didn't really hear much about it. And again, it's kind of like the first one. I knew about it for quite a while. I just didn't see any reason I think I'd be into it, you know. It is a pretty good action platformer game. And while it is primarily a platformer, without a doubt, it does place a heavy emphasis on combat. There is a ton of combat in this. In fact, so much, there are certain points within the different areas you go in Wonderland, like the Mad Hatter's Domain, Queensland, stuff like that, where many times within those levels you'll be locked into a room or a place that's kind of like an arena, almost like Painkiller, and you have to kill the enemies before you can leave, and there's a barrier that won't go away until you defeat the enemies or some kind of sub-boss. So it does actually place quite a lot of emphasis on combat, which is surprising. I didn't really expect that. Outside of the combat, which I'll come back to, that's actually something specific I want to talk about. The platforming itself actually is pretty good in this game, and while the game isn't what you would call exactly very long, if you go looking for the collectibles, which I'm going to come back to too, it actually makes the levels a little bit more, expand a little bit, and you get to see a little bit more of the levels and explore more, and the levels become bigger, and actually that does drag the game out quite a lot longer than if you don't search for the collectibles, which there's a lot of those. But primarily it's a platforming game, and the platforming does work really well in this, although there are a few problems with the game. For one, the camera does mess with you quite a lot, and oftentimes, but most of the time it's not no issue, especially when you're in combat, you have a lock-on camera, which works and helps alleviate that for the most part. And sometimes there are certain jumps that just don't want to work right for whatever reason, but a lot of times there is no penalty for dying. If you fall off a cliff or something like that, for example, you just respawn. You don't even lose any health, so that is kind of a disappointment, I guess you could say, at the same time, is that there's no actual consequence for dying. Then again, remember, Wonderland is in Alice's head, so whatever rules she wants to make up, I guess that flies. Maybe that's what you're supposed to think of. Anyway, this takes place 10 years after the events of the first one, which is called American McGee's Alice. American McGee, by the way, is the one who thinks up all this and came up with the design for Alice's more twisted-looking Wonderland. He actually was part of the team that made the original Doom, by the way. Anyway, this takes place 10 years after that, and Alice Little, as her full name is, you play as her, of course, and she is basically gone mental in the real world and in Wonderland, and as the Cheshire Cat tells you, one is directly affected by the other. So the way she is in the real world affects the way Wonderland is, and the way Wonderland is affects her in the real world. As a result, her mind is in pieces and shattered. She's, you know, going off the deep end, and to fix herself, she needs to fix problems that are going on in Wonderland. And when she goes back in there, she finds out that there is a evil demon train, looks like a cathedral almost, that's going through and destroying various areas of Wonderland, so she has to stop the infernal train from wrecking everything, which, as a result, like I said, in the real world results in her going more and more crazy. So that's basically the overall theme of what's going on here. You need to fix your own mind and fix Wonderland, and Alice is constantly tormented by her family being burned alive in her house, and she's accused of setting the fire. But as you go through the game, you find out more and more pieces of the story and what actually happened and who actually did it. So it's almost kind of like a murder mystery type plot in a way too. It's a little odd. And of course you come across many of the familiar characters that you see from Alice in Wonderland, you know, the Cheshire Cat, the Queen. None of them look the same way as they did. the Mad Hatter, and you also see the White Rabbit, but he's a little bit different. You only see him a little bit. He's in the beginning, and then after that, you only see him as kind of like a ghost, I guess you would say. But that's something else entirely. Anyway, I mentioned the combat was a big part of the game, and it really is. You have only four weapons, but each one serves multiple uses, and you also have a shield, which is kind of like an umbrella, but you can also use it to reflect shots back, which you need to use in certain enemies. The four weapons are the Vorpal Blade, which is actually a returning one from the previous first game, which essentially is a giant kitchen knife. It's Alice's trademark weapon. You also have another one in this, a new one, the Hobby Horse, which is kind of like a hammer. It's your more powerful, slower attack you have. So those are your two melee moves you can use, or weapons, I should say. You also have two projectile weapons. One is a kind of a machine gun. It's a peppermill grinder, which primarily you can use in combat, which is very useful, but it's also used for collecting a certain other collectible, which are pig snouts. You have to pepper them. I'll come back to those when I come back to the collectibles. You also have a teapot cannon, which essentially is kind of like a mortar grenade, and that works very well too. It's much more powerful than the peppermint grinder. So you have two projectile weapons and you have two melee weapons. You also have, you get fairly early on, a kind of landmine you can use, or a bomb, which looks like the White Rabbit, and he's got a clock on it. It's a cool little design. Primarily, you actually don't even use that for combat, but you can. It tells you that certain weapons make good combos together, which they do, like that and the peppermill grinder. You can use that the bomb to stun enemies while you go up to them and whack them with the hobby horse, for example. But it's primarily actually used to weigh down certain stepping weights so you can move certain platforms, because there's only one of you. So you more often than not use it in platforming, which I'll give them credit, that is kind of creative to use a weapon to help you do platforming, because a lot of times you have to do timed jumps and things like that, and you have to move platforms in the right place, otherwise you won't be able to make them to it. You won't be able to make it there, so you have to use the bomb to lay on one weight, then you stay on the other one, and you have to quickly get over to the other place. Sometimes it's a little tricky with certain parts in the game, but you get used to it pretty quick. The platforming isn't what I would really call overly difficult, and it's pretty clear where you have to go. The game itself is very linear. The levels aren't open or anything like that, and you can't really freely explore, as I said in the beginning, unless you go after collectibles, and it kind of expands a little bit. And some of the collectibles aren't that well hitting, I'll be honest. They're kind of out right in front of you, or sometimes right behind you as soon as you start a new checkpoint. But some of the other ones are a little bit more hidden, which kind of leads me into the collectibles themselves. There's quite a few of them. And I'll start off with the pig snouts, which I already mentioned, which you have to pepper with a peppermill grinder. There's very few of them in the game. They're actually invisible, but there's a trademark sign. You can hear them making the snorting sound like a pig makes, and that lets you know they're nearby. Or sometimes, like I said, they're just right out in the open. You can see them clearly. The thing with these is, sometimes you actually need to get these pig snouts in order to get access to the other collectibles, because a lot of times when you pepper these pig snouts and they go away, they'll either reveal platforms that weren't already there, or they will give you a basket that has a bunch of gold teeth in it, which is another collectible which I'm coming to. And so a lot of times if you need to get a memory collectible, for example, you might actually need to find the pig nose first so it can give you a platform you can jump on to get there. Again, it's that kind of meta platforming they came up with in this, much like you have to use the rabbit bomb to lay on a platform, the pressure plate to make a platform appear. So it's kind of creative that you need one to get the other. The other collectibles, though, are in the form of memories. These give you little short audio logs, think kind of like Bioshock in a way. And each one is a different symbol which correlates to a different character. Like, say, if it's a one that looks like a little house, that's Alice's own particular memories. Then you also have one which is for Professor Bumby and a couple other characters. And those talk to you, and you find a little bit more about the backstory and things that are going on and what they think about what Alice is going on. Stuff like that. You also have other collectibles that don't say or do anything really, and they're kind of boring. They're bottles, so you have those you can collect too. And just like the other ones, that are hidden, sometimes better than others. And the other collectible you have is, well, there's actually technically another one, but that's not really a collectible. It's something you have to do to get it. But the other collectible you have, which is the main one you want to get, are teeth. They come in two forms, normal white ones, which only give you one, and then gold ones, which give you about three or five. These are specifically used they're essentially currency. What you do is you collect enough of these, and you can actually upgrade your four weapons. And each time you do, they cost progressively more and more and more, and it requires more to collect them. So it takes a while to get everything fully upgraded to level 4, but once you do, you're very powerful. So you want to collect those a lot too, and again, it's another incentive to go around looking in levels, because you go in these keyholes, and that's where a lot of these memories are in bottles. There's also boxes in there that you could break up, and there's teeth, and a lot of times you'll find gold teeth in there. And again, when you do the pig snail thing, sometimes it'll give you a basket which has quite a lot of teeth in there, all in one go. So again, another incentive for exploring the levels and finding all the collectibles besides getting 100% completion, you know? In the PlayStation 3 and Xbox 360 versions, obviously there's achievements for this, so that's another incentive if you're into those. There is one other type of collectible, but in order to get this, you don't actually go around looking for them. What you do is you go into these snail shell things, essentially. They're called Rotunda Challenge Rooms, and these tend to be the more difficult things you can do. Sometimes you just are grilled by the Cheshire Cat and asked questions in his typical riddle form, which some of them are kind of confusing, but if you think about them, you can solve the answer easily. At first, I thought maybe if I just, because I saw the Disney animated movie so long ago, which I barely remember, by the way, it would help you answer the questions. Not so much, it's just obvious kind of things. You got to think about it, though. It's not the kind of riddle that is like the Riddler, for example. They're very obscure, like in Arkham City. These are simple enough. But the other ones, most of the time, are combat challenges, where either you have to just survive and not get killed, or you have to take out all the enemies within a certain amount of time. And if you do, you get one of four pieces each time to upgrade it. It's called Paint the Rose Red, and every time you collect four of these, you upgrade your health by one full heart unit. So that's another collectible that you have. So there's actually quite a lot in this game to keep you busy besides just going through the levels. Now, if you say, for example, if you don't go for these collectibles or you already got them, you're playing on New Game Plus, which this game does have, by the way, which is very nice. The levels you'll find are actually very short and very fast. Although there are, like I said, there are some rooms where you're kind of locked in there and you have to kill the enemies before you can progress. And there are, I'll be honest, there are some parts in this game, whether it's because of certain more difficult enemies or just a lot of enemies in general, that it can drag on and become a lot, or pretty frustrating, I'll be honest. There's this one enemy which I can't remember the exact name right now. It's basically a giant tower of goo, and once you will it down enough in health, it'll actually start chasing you around with a giant flamethrower cannon. That enemy is pretty annoying unless you figure out the trick to taking them out quick, but things like that can sometimes create problems, but other than that, not so much. Like I said earlier, the camera sometimes fights you along with that, so those are a few of the issues that you'll come across in the game. There are also some other things in this besides just the combat and the platforming. Once you get to a certain point later on in the game, essentially the third world, you come across slider puzzles. There's not that many in the game, there's only a few. But maybe this is just a personal thing to me. I'll be honest, I don't really like slider puzzles. They're not difficult, they really aren't. And especially the ones in this, they're not that challenging, except for the one later on, it's a crying boy in the dollhouse area of Wonderland. But they're very easy, very short and simple to do, and they don't really require that much thinking, and you can do them pretty quick. You have a certain amount of moves you have to do them in, and if not, you just restart over. There's no actual real penalty, and that's all there is to it. There's also, only in Queensland, a couple of chess challenges, which are kind of like the slider puzzles. They're essentially the same kind of idea, except for you have to move your two chess pieces you control at the same time. They're inverted, white and red, and you have to move them in their opposite places, but you have to deal with certain other chess pieces that want to take yours out. And if you get through that in the right amount of moves, you'll just win and you progress. Those are pretty simple. I actually like those quite a lot, but slider puzzles are just something I've never personally myself been big on, ever. But they're alright. I do, even though I don't really like slider puzzles, I do think these are actually a good thing to have in a game, because it kind of breaks up the monotony if you're just doing a lot of combat or a lot of platforming, which there is a lot of both in this game. There's also one other type of different gameplay in this, where it's still platforming, but more pure platforming, for example. And I have an example or two in this video here, so you can see it. And you start coming across these fairly early on, too, again, kind of in the oriental area of Wonderland, is when you start seeing them, is these very beautiful-looking, I don't know how to explain it exactly, almost like paper cutout look to it. Not exactly like Okami, if you know what that game is, but straight up 2D platforming, where you can't do any kind of combat or anything like that, and you just do platforming. They're few and far between, but they're really nice, and they're really good looking visually. They have a cool aesthetic to them. They are pretty difficult, too, in some ways, because the camera likes to zoom in a lot, and you can't see where you're going, and you can't fight any enemies back that are in there, so you have to just dodge them. There's one other thing I forgot to mention, is very, very early on, you also get the ability to shrink yourself. This is very useful for so many ways, and in these 2D platforming segments, that's really the only way you can dodge some attacks, by the way. But other than that, when you go into shrink mode, as I call it, in the 3D world, the normal mode of the game, you can use that to find hidden platforms that you can jump on to get to, a lot of times, collectibles, memories, teeth, whatever it might be, or alternate path around. Or you can also use it just to get through the game. Sometimes you have to. And they disappear pretty quick when you're not in shrink mode anymore. But you can also find written on walls, like, kind of clues or hints as telling you there's danger coming up or what character you're about to come across, like the caterpillar or the queen or something like that. So it's a pretty cool thing you can use, and a lot of times it will help you figure out which way you need to go if you get lost. So that's another nice thing you can have. Don't really have much else to say about the game. The music is pretty cool. It fits the theme of the game really well, and the whole kind of gothic, like Tim Burton-esque feel, as I mentioned in the beginning of this. Taking the camera frustrations out and how it wants to kind of kill you sometimes and don't want to work right. The combat works very well, very simple controls. It works really good. You just kind of have to counter some enemies. Depending on how strong they are, you have to use a certain weapon to beat them. The combat, while it's not exactly what you would call complex, actually has enough depth to it that keeps it interesting. It's not just mash one button to win, you know. It's not use the Vorpal Blade on every enemy and then they're dead. A lot of them, the weaker ones, you can, but some of the other ones, you actually have to block their attacks, reflect it back at them before you can actually start hurting them, and you have to actually dodge around them so you don't get hurt. Things like that, it's pretty fun. And if you do take full-on damage and you're pretty much dead, you enter rage mode, which keeps you invincible. Everything goes monochrome except for things that are basically red, you know, like blood. And Alice just goes in a berserker rage and you do a ton of damage. You're invincible. You don't get any health back from it, but it does give you a chance to take out whatever enemies that might kill you. So that's pretty cool too. And you also get different dresses in the game depending on what area you're in. And this is one of the last things I want to talk about, is once you beat the game New Game Plus, you actually are allowed to choose whatever dresses you want in whatever place you want to go. You can actually do this before you beat the game, but when you beat the game, you actually unlock whatever special ability that dress has. Each dress has their own kind of power to it, which again gives you another incentive for replaying the game besides finding all the collectibles that maybe you didn't and get 100% completion or playing on a harder difficulty. Things like that. So there is incentive to replay the game and or just speedrun through it, I guess. Other than that, I don't really have much else to say other than one other thing, and it's specific to the computer version. The game runs very well. Doesn't really have any problems with crashing or kind of frame rate issues. However, for whatever reason, the computer version is gimped to 30 frames a second by default. It's locked. However, you can actually go into the game's files and unlock it to 60 frames a second, which I highly recommend doing, especially with a game like this. When you do, it still runs perfectly fine, and it's even more enjoyable and looks even better to play. I gotta say though, with the few minor annoyances out of the way, the camera and things like that, this is actually a very, very fun platformer action game. It's a really cool looking game. Very odd and twisted World of Wonderland version of it, and I like it a lot. I didn't think I would originally. It's a really cool game. I highly recommend checking it out, especially if you're like me and, you know, you like these kind of games and you want something a little bit different, or you like the look of this. It's pretty cool. The story itself is actually pretty interesting, and while the game isn't the longest, it actually does last a decent amount of time, as long as it needs to, really, I think. So I really enjoyed my time with this game. And, you know, again, if you like games where you collect a lot of stuff, it's also good for that, all the different collectibles. So, there you go. Quite a lot to talk about, but that's Alice Madness Returns. A very interesting game, for sure. Anyway, that's it. Thank you for watching, and I will see you later.